Illinois Stories is brought to you by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello, welcome to Illinois Stories. I'm Mark McDonald in Quincy at the YMCA, where they have the privilege of having the oldest working lifeguard in the world in 92-year-old Louie Demers. But it's not just his lifeguarding. You will be amazed at the other things that Louie has done in his life and continues to do at the age of what he calls 92.8. Let me introduce you to Louie Demers of Quincy. 92 years and 8 months old. Is that right?
Yeah.
92 years and 8 months old. And you get a lot of recognition for your age, but not just for your age. You get a lot of recognition because you've done some wonderful things in your life. And Louie, everybody speaks well of you, and that's maybe the most important thing you've ever done.
Yeah.
But we'll get back to that. The reason we have Louie here today is because a number of things. He's 92 some years old. He's the oldest active lifeguard. It says the Guinness Book of World Records in the world, right?
7 billions or 8 billions, I forget how many billions.
You're the oldest, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You're in the Illinois Aviation Hall of Fame.
Yes. Yeah.
And you just got your pilot instructor certification renewed, right? So you can continue to do that for a while.
Yeah, for 2 more
and
years.
And didn't you just get your lifeguard certification
just
renewed, too?
Just got renewed, too.
So you have no intention of quitting lifeguarding?
Oh, no.
We're at the Y. How often do you lifeguard here?
About 3 times a week. And I also lifeguard out the Illinois Veterans Home.
Is that right?
Mondays and Fridays.
Yeah.
In fact, next week I'll be out there Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday because one of the lifeguards is going on vacation.
They can always count on you for a few extra hours.
You've got
an evening job, don't you? Don't you work in the evening?
I work for a funeral home here in Quincy, Duker and Hall Funeral Home.
And what do you do for them?
I'm a greeter at the door.
Oh, good for you.
Yeah,
good
and that way I meet a lot of people I still know, and it's a rewarding job. It's just something to do and keep active.
And you know how fortunate you are to be as active as you are, don't you?
Yeah.
You really know how to count your blessings, don't you?
Yes, sir. That's right.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
Let's talk about you when you were a very young man. You always wanted to be a pilot, almost always.
Yeah.
Because I remember, everybody remembers Wiley Post, who was a famous aviator.
Yeah.
But he had a scrape here in Quincy one time, didn't he, back in 1933, old enough to remember it. What happened in Quincy?
Well, when he was taking off, he had a crosswind, and he clipped some telephone posts on the south end of the old Monroe Airport, and he wrapped up that old Lockheed Vega.
You brought a picture and an article here from the past, and this is from the Herald Whig of 1982, but it recalls this particular situation in 1933, and this had a bearing on your plans, didn't it?
That planted the seed, I guess.
Yeah, and what was that?
To be a pilot someday.
Is that right?
Yep. I wanted to be. I don't know why. What? Not only that, then the trimotor Ford, the Flying Ben, came over from Kansas City.
Uh-huh.
He had 2 trimotors. Taking passengers, he had 2 trimotors, 1 passenger, and the other one he had a bunch of lights hooked up underneath in the fuselage to shine up underneath the wings, and at night he would fly around Quincy, and you know, back in those days, my God.
You didn't see many planes, did you?
No.
And it took your breath away, I'll bet.
Yes, it did.
Let's look at that trimotor, because we got some pictures of it right here. In fact, here's you.
Yeah.
In later years,
in
front of the trimotor, you finally got a ride, didn't you?
No, I flew it.
You flew it?
Yeah, I flew it. I took the news media up, and we, of course, we flew out over town and came in, and he left me landed too, so that was a big thrill. And the controls on it, see the airplanes nowadays, they have backup controls and stuff like that. Yeah. Well, this thing is just, really manual. Yeah. Like
so when you were a kid and you paid 50 cents to ride in this plane, that got you hooked, didn't it?
That got me hooked,
okay. And here, look, we see the Illinois Aviation Hall of Fame right here on the right.
Yeah.
This is your certificate for being inducted, and this was back in 2012. So you were not a kid at the time you got inducted into the Hall of Fame.
Oh, no.
And here you're recognized down here, too, with the Wright Brothers Master Pilot Award down here on the bottom from the Department of Transportation, the FAA.
Yeah, yeah.
And not only did you turn your career, your piloting career, you actually went to work as a out of the airport, right?
Yes. Before, let's see, let me get this right. I worked for the FAA, and I also, in between, before I got hired for the FAA, I went out west. My brother had a dusting operation in Salem.
Oh, those are all crop dusters that we're looking at?
Those are all crop dusters, yeah.
Ah, okay.
What a lot of work. We worked on them. Airplane day and night sometimes.
Yeah, and you can see right below that, you can see where that, I guess
yep.
they're loading them up
yep.
with the
loading them up. And
the dust.
I was out there for about a year, mm-hmm. and my lovely wife was a telephone operator here in Quincy, and she had a job, and I really, this is kind of a wildcat job.
Yeah,
way, you know,
yeah.
Because you depend on the weather, you depend yeah. on the farmers, and you just, and she, but I wanted her to move out with me, mm-hmm. and she says, "No, you come back to Quincy." So I came back. Probably the best thing ever happened to me.
It probably saved your life.
I know.
You'd have crashed one of those, I'll
oh,
bet.
We lost a lot of pilots.
Yeah,
a lot of pilots.
Yeah. Let's walk down this way and take a look at your lovely wife, because you do have a picture of her here.
Yeah, yeah.
Down at the bottom.
Yeah.
And this is you when you were in the Navy, and
yep.
you two were married for how many years,
Louie? 67 years.
67
yeah.
years. She insisted you come back to Quincy.
Yes, you're right, yeah.
And do a regular job, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so you spent 30 years in the control tower.
Yeah,
as a
yeah,
traffic controller.
Flight service. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, yeah. These are a couple of my honorable discharges. And,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now you had the a memorable situation. You were in the Navy from 1940. Okay, from 1940 on. So you actually predated Pearl Harbor. You were
yes.
in the Navy before Pearl Harbor.
Let me correct that.
Okay.
In December of 1940, I signed up for the Navy, and they sent me home, said, "Come back the 1st of January." So I went through Great Lake training mm-hmm. in the worst possible for weather in January up
there.
At Great Lake.
Cold.
So that's 1941, yeah. the beginning of 1941.
Right.
So I was practically in... you might say pretty near 12 months
mm-hmm.
when Pearl Harbor hit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
you wanted pilot training. That's
right.
what you wanted.
Yes,
you
right.
couldn't get it, could you?
Nope.
They kept putting you in some kind of other training. What was your first training situation?
Well, going really getting nitty gritty, I was on a gun mount back on a fantail of this tin can.
Well, point that out to us.
Okay. The back gun mount, 5-inch 38 gun mm-hmm. mount, didn't have any protection like up here on the front,
mm-hmm.
you know, and every time you had to go out there, and every time you got in bad weather, or you run in rough seas and maneuvers and
yeah.
stuff, and it was horrible.
What kind of ship is that?
That's a destroyer.
Okay, so yeah. that was your first.
That was my first
okay.
ship.
Then you yeah. put in for pilot training again, and what did they give you?
They sent me to Boston, Massachusetts,
mm-hmm.
to put the Boston in commission, and that was a heavy cruiser.
Uh-huh.
I went out. I put over a year in that back out in the Pacific, which mm-hmm. that chart over there shows.
Yeah.
And I put in they opened it up again for bids. So I put in for flying cadet mm-hmm. again. And they sent me to New London, Connecticut submarine school.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, and I was in training for a couple of weeks there at the sub school
yeah.
and at Rhode Island. We had an old chief. Name, I forget, Chief, what the heck is his name? I thought he was an admiral. I mean, he was mean.
Mm-hmm.
Anyhow, they called me in the office, the executive office in charge of personnel. I thought, but my bid really comes through.
Mm-hmm.
So, no, you're going to Norfolk, Virginia. They had a new light cruiser that the Navy built, and I mean, I'm sorry, the civilian
mm-hmm.
built, but before they turned it over to the Navy, you had to go down on a shakedown cruise. And so I went back mm-hmm. out in the Pacific, and I did the rest of the time chasing Japanese out in the Pacific. And
now, in December of 1941, when Pearl Harbor occurred, that was your home port, right?
Right.
That was your
yep.
home base.
Yeah. Yeah.
You happened to be off several hundred miles
yeah.
away at the time, which was very fortunate for
yes.
you.
Yes, yes, right.
Because you would have been docked right
oh,
near
gosh, yeah.
the Arizona,
yes.
isn't that right?
Definitely, yeah.
yeah.
Our buoy was right around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we was with the Enterprise. the Yorktown and the Saratoga on fleet, what they call fleet maneuvers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you're a fortunate man, although you began to see a lot of heavy action after that.
Yeah.
Because then the South Pacific just lit up with activity.
Yeah, they jumped from one island to another.
Yeah.
There's a lot of,
yeah.
lost a lot of good people
oh,
out
my goodness,
there, a
yeah.
lot of good people.
Yeah, yeah.
We did bypass Truk. Truk was, Truk Island was like Pearl Harbor to us for the Japanese, but they had a bunch of reefs all around Truk Island,
mm-hmm.
and they figured it'd be too costly for us to invade Truk Island, so they bypassed that. So then from there we went to Iwo Jima because MacArthur wanted to get Iwo Jima, and then he went to, as soon as he got Iwo Jima, he wanted to get Okinawa so we could invade Japan. So
pick up that knife for me if you would. And let's take it out of the sheath too, because I wanna illustrate for people here. Everybody on your ship had a knife like this.
That's
and
right.
they kept it, they slept with it. They kept it very close to them,
yeah,
didn't they?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, if you get torpedoed, like I said, we hit that whale one time, the whole ship lifted up in the back end, the whale chewed up the prop chewed up the whale, and it scared the heck out of us. Well, we thought we were torpedoed. You don't have time to run to your locker and get your gear, because you're going over the side, abandoned ship like now, you know.
Yeah. So why do you want this with you?
For protection, for sharks, stuff like that.
Really, if you're floating around out there?
Yeah, that. Or it's handy to have in case in the Navy they call them lines, and civilian it's ropes. If you get a sailor tangled up in a rope on deck, you could cut the rope quick.
Yeah.
So to avoid an injury. Yeah. I mean, it comes in handy more than for that. And also you could open up your rations too if it had to be. You know, it more.
But mostly, if you're going to be floating around in the sea, you want to be able to protect your legs from the sharks.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yes. Oh yeah.
Well, Louie, you have sort of recorded your life history from the Boy Scouts on through the service, right? With the medals that you've been given.
Yeah.
And you start out on the upper left up here with your first Boy Scout medals.
Tenderfoot.
Now why do you put your Boy Scout medals in with your service medals?
Well, because the background, it was good training. It was good training. And it benefited me in the long run. When I went in the Navy, I knew a lot of things about, like, swimming and different marching, that was on drills and stuff like that. I knew my right foot from my left foot, which some of the guys in the Navy didn't know their right foot from the left foot, that's for sure.
Yeah.
And of course, then these are some of my flying deals with the FAA.
These here?
These.
Which ones? Are these up here?
Yeah.
These are flying?
Yeah,
okay.
More or less, yeah.
Okay, all right. And then these are actually from your service medals.
That's my good conduct medal, Asiatic Pacific.
Okay, let's look at that one for a little bit. Asiatic position. This is the one I guess you're most proud of, because
that
was, you really, really risked your life for a number of years there, didn't you, for that? Yeah.
Not only mine, but a lot of other guys.
Yeah. And these were your original dog tags up here?
Yeah, that's my original one. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I'll be darned. Well, that's wonderful to preserve that.
Yeah. And this over here is my shell back. I don't know if you got that. My certificate.
This here? Okay.
Yeah.
And what is it certified for?
Well, when
you
go across the equator, you get initiated in this, I don't know if you want to call it a club or not, but before you go across the equator, you're a polywog. You're the scum of the sea.
Oh,
see?
Okay.
And when you go across the equator, I guess you really become a sailor then.
I guess. Oh, so this was the Navy that bestows this on you.
Yeah.
You've come of age, I guess, once you run across the equator.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah,
now we talked a little bit about this too. It's a little off topic, but you know, the Guinness World Records certifies you as the oldest active lifeguard.
Yeah.
But this is way back in 1988.
Mm-hmm.
Or when you were 88 years old.
Yeah, that's when
so you've got that record beaten by a long shot.
Oh, yeah.
Nobody's got you beat
yet. Caught up with me yet.
And this is, now we talked about your career in aviation.
Mainly this come from the people I worked with out the FAA.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what did you do for the FAA?
I was what they call an air traffic controller at the flight service station out there.
Mm-hmm.
We directed traffic, we gave airport advisory, we took weather observations all the time, special weather observations. If the weather went down to IFR conditions, like minimums, when the weather started going below 1,000 feet, why we had to take more observations because the pilots used to have to come in on instruments then, see. Mm-hmm. And of course, we have a full ILS instrument landing system out there. And well, anyhow, we get down to minimums, what they call minimums. Mm-hmm. And airplanes at that time could take off on minimum, in fact, 0-0. But as far as landing on 0-0, mm-hmm. we didn't have that ability mm-hmm. at that particular mm-hmm. time.
In fact, you didn't even have a tower out there,
no,
did you?
No, no.
You weren't up in a tower?
No.
Were you just using binoculars, basically?
Well, yeah. We had the view of the terminal building had glasses all around where we uh-huh. could see all the runways, approach ends, all the runways. Mm-hmm. So we were kind of like controlled, but yet it wasn't really designated as a control tower.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
so like over Springfield.
And you didn't have any radar?
No
right?
radar. The only way we get a lost airplane is a direction finder. Mm-hmm. When you transmit on a certain frequency, like 123, I think was a frequency mm-hmm. out there, this sent out a beam on a scope, mm-hmm. sent out a beam, and what you do, you tell the pilot, you get a bearing going out, you get tell the pilot reciprocal, bring them right to the airport. Mm-hmm. It was really a good feature. It was a low-cost deal. Yeah. And we used to have quite a few pilots get disorientated. Mm-hmm. That's a nice word saying, not lost, just
exactly.
disorientated.
Yeah.
So you got to be careful.
Right. You know. So. And look here. Now, not too many years ago, you were given the key to the city of Quincy. Yeah. Isn't that something?
Well, I volunteer on a lot of things, you know, at QU for the Red Cross and stuff mm-hmm. like that. A lot went into that. That's no big deal, but I appreciate it.
Well, it is a big deal because you're a busy man. Even at 92.8, you're still a busy man, so you still volunteer as well. See, I didn't know that about you.
Yeah.
The Red Cross, any other volunteer activities?
QU.
I'm sorry, QU.
Yeah. No, I can't think of anything right now. You know? Of course, I worked down the funeral home. We covered that. And I work here at the Y, so that's
about it, huh?
Yeah.
That's about it.
Yeah.
Well, listen, Louie, I want to thank you for coming in. We've got some other people here that we want to talk to about you. Okay. You and your lovely wife were married, 67?
67 years.
67 years.
Yeah.
And had one daughter.
Yeah, Mary.
And we get a chance to meet Mary.
Yeah.
And we also wanted to talk to your employees out here at the Y, who are very proud that you're... one of their employees.
Well, I appreciate
that. And we'll get a chance to do that as well.
Okay.
So thanks a lot.
Okay, you're welcome. Shake your hand.
Mary Demers, are you aware that your father is an extraordinary person?
I am aware, but I thank you for stating that. Yes, thank you.
You know, I imagine that you hear this all the time because for a number of reasons. I mean, he's a remarkable person, but his age also makes him more of a remarkable person. He's able mm-hmm. to do all, and he's very thankful that he can do mm-hmm. all these things at the age of almost 93 years old.
Yes.
But you must be very proud of him.
I am. I'm happy to admit it. He's a remarkable man and just a wonderful father. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, he has been fortunate and blessed to have had a number of accomplishments in his life, but I think probably the job he's best at is just being a dad mm-hmm. and having been a wonderful husband to my mom for so many years.
Yeah. You get to share a lot of this. A lot of these awards that came to him came later in life.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to share a lot of this. And I think this is a really neat one up here, this Illinois, when he was inducted into the Aviation Hall of Fame in Illinois up in St. Charles.
Yes.
You got to go with him and enjoy it with him and describe this experience.
Well, it was a magical event. It really was. We, thanks to the generosity of one of his friends, were able to fly up in that gentleman's airplane, and mm-hmm. You know, it was a trip. We left Quincy mid-afternoon. We were back in Quincy by probably 11 o'clock that night. Had a wonderful banquet and an award ceremony, and mm-hmm. just to see him in that group of people being honored in that fashion, I was pretty proud of him.
And to get to fly up. Of course,
yes,
he always wants to get
fly
on an
up.
Airplane,
yes,
doesn't
yes.
he?
Yes. And actually, he got the thrill of, actually, the main pilot and I were in the back seat on the way up, and Dad mm-hmm. and the co-pilot were actually flying the plane, which was kind of laughable.
Wouldn't want to be anywhere else.
No.
You say you took this picture, right?
I believe I did.
Yeah?
That
okay.
is when the Ford Tri-Motor came to Quincy. It'll be 3 years ago in mm-hmm. June. Our local EAA chapter brought the Ford tri-motor in, and Dad was fortunate enough to be able to sit in the right seat and co-pilot a flight around Quincy. It was actually happened to be the media flights of all the local TV and radio personalities. Mm-hmm. So
see, we get to go for free.
Yeah, I know.
Everybody else has to pay, but
we
get to go for free.
Well, Dad was able to show the pilot, who is naturally not from Quincy, kind of when you take your tours over Quincy, these are highlights that you might want to see and highlights of the Quincy and the community and the river and things. Dad has had a lot of experience taking people on flights,
sure,
around Quincy, so that worked out very well. So, and I think I was standing down there ready to snap that picture.
You were also, like, for instance, you remember very well when the Department of Transportation, FAA, made him the master pilot.
Yes. Yes, I do. That happened in
2005.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and that was really one of the first major awards I remember him getting, mm-hmm, and that was presented over at Mattoon, Illinois, when he volunteers every summer over at an aviation safety seminar. And
at the age of 90, at the age of 92, almost 3, he's still checking out pilots to make sure they're doing the right things.
Okay. Yes, he is still a certified flight instructor. Yeah. His certification as a flight instructor, he's kept that current.
Yeah.
So,
remarkable.
Interesting story about the Ford tri-motor, back to that. Mm-hmm. Dad will tell you the story that is what really piqued his interest in aviation. Mm-hmm. There was a Ford tri-motor that came to Quincy when he was, 10 years old. And so that plane had special, that was just a special time for him to be able to fly that plane.
And so he climbs back in it again, and, mm-hmm, and off he goes.
Yes.
Listen, thank you for taking time off and visiting with us. It's been a wonderful time to spend with him. And I know, like I said, you must be very proud of him. But I think people probably remark to you all the time about your dad, and it's just wonderful. Now you don't know how much time you have left with him, but don't you just count every day and just be thankful for it, don't you?
Yes. Yeah. Definitely so.
Yeah. Thank you.
Definitely
Mary.
So. Well, thank you very much.
Brandon Dowdy, when you came to the Y here in Quincy, you'd worked at a lot of YMCAs before, right?
I have, yes.
For a fairly brief amount of time. Mm-hmm. And when you found out that you had a 92-plus-year-old lifeguard working here, what was your response to that?
You know, the YMCA and the Quincy community has a rich history. And to meet an individual that has a Guinness World Record for being the oldest active lifeguard right here at the Quincy YMCA was very special. He exemplifies everything the Y is about, caring, honesty, respect, responsibility, really brings to the table a lot that his peer staff, our other employees can learn from. So Louie is what I would call a pace setter, shows up early, stays late, and he still really is one of the guys who's put in the extra. And at the Y, his presence is felt, whether it's in the coffee group or out here on the pool deck. His participation and leadership is well respected.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I noticed we spent a little bit of time here today, but I noticed he knows all the members, and he knows something about them because he immediately brought up something that they were shared, a concern that they shared, an interest that they shared. So everybody's kind of perks up when he comes around.
That's right. You? Yeah, everybody here knows Louie. Everybody in town knows Louie. He has such a rich personal history, and relationship life is based on relationships. And here at the Y, we teach relationship building for membership. And what Louie does for that comes naturally in who he is and how he was raised. He's from the greatest generation, and wow, what mm-hmm. we can learn from people like Louie.
Yeah. And Louie, when I asked Louie, I said, Louie, I want you to be on the pool deck for us today. And he said, well, I got to be prepared, so I'm going to be walking the deck, and I'm going to be watching the swimmers, and there he is over there. Now, he never takes his eye off the pool, does he? He's always working.
That's right. Yeah, he's the old Boy Scout motto, always be prepared.
Well, it must be really nice to have somebody like that on staff, because like you say, you have a lot of younger people on staff. Sometimes it helps a whole lot to have a wise older guy, doesn't it?
Absolutely, and there's a big percentage of our membership that are not obviously of Louis's age, but he brings a comfort level to our senior population, our older, our active adults, when he's either, you know, socializing with them or they're participating in a training that he's offering for life savings or overseeing a program in the pool here.
Yeah. And we were talking to me how busy he stays. I said, well, how much does he work? And you said, well, he doesn't only work 3 days a week. He works in the evening, too.
That's right. He fills in for people when they're away. He's the great sub. He's also our first aid and life-saving certifier for our employees. And
so no kidding. He really is?
It's amazing. Absolutely. Absolutely.
First aid and CPR, huh? Well, good for him.
Yeah, you'll see him. I came for a meeting the other night, 7 o'clock in the evening, and went to the conference room, and there was Louie in there with the videos playing and conducting the test. It's just great to see. He has as much or more energy than most of us. And we could figure out the recipe of what makes Louie, we'd all be millionaires.
I wish we could. And we'd live forever, wouldn't we?
Yeah, and I think that's part of what makes, you know, Louie's participation here at the Y unique. Is because we are open to all, and Louie is evident of that. And as you asked at the beginning of our conversation, one of the uniques that I saw when I first came on, and Louie is one of those. It's not by accident that there's a 92-year-old lifeguard at the Quincy YMCA. Louie's here for a reason.
Brandon, thank you very much.
No, absolutely. I appreciate it.
And Louie doesn't show any signs of slowing down anytime soon. He's got his 3 days a week here, but he's going to work more next week because somebody needs time off teaching CPR at night. He's out at the Veterans Home lifeguarding out there. And he'll be going back to Mattoon in June again to check out those pilots. With another Illinois story in Quincy, I'm Mark McDonald. Thanks for watching.
Illinois Stories is brought to you by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the support of viewers like you. Thank you. For a DVD copy of the program you've just seen, send $19.95 to Network Knowledge, P.O. Box 6248, Springfield, Illinois 62708. Be sure to include the program name, subject, and when the program aired. You can also order with your credit card by calling 800-232-3605.